and mentally repeated with all his soul, "Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me." But he had heard everything. He had heard how the silk rustled when she took off her dress, how she stepped with bare feet on the floor, and had heard how she rubbed her feet with her hand. He felt his own weakness, and that he might be lost at any moment. That was why he prayed unceasingly. He felt rather as the hero in the fairy tale must have felt when he had to go on and on without looking round. So Sergius heard and felt that danger and destruction were there, hovering above and around him, and that he could only save himself by not looking in that direction for an instant. But suddenly the desire to look seized him. At the same instant she said, "This is inhuman. I may die." "Yes, I will go to her." But like the saint who laid one hand on the adulteress and thrust his other into the brazier. But there is no brazier here, he looked round. The lamp. He put his finger over the flame and frowned, preparing himself to suffer. And for a rather long time, as it seemed to him, there was no sensation. But suddenly, he had not yet decided whether it was painful enough, he writhed all over, jerked his hand away, and waved it in the air. "No, I can't stand that. For God's sake, come to me. I'm dying. Oh, well, shall I perish? No, no, not so." "I will come to you directly," he said, and having opened his door, he went without looking at her through the cell into the porch where he used to chop wood. There he felt for the block and for an axe which leant against the wall. "Immediately," he said, and taking up the axe with his right hand, he laid the forefinger of his left hand on the block, swung the axe, and struck with it below the second joint. The finger flew off more lightly than a stick of similar thickness, and, bounding up, turned over on the edge of the block and then fell to the floor. He heard it fall before he felt any pain, but before he had time to be surprised, he felt a burning pain and the warmth of flowing blood. He hastily wrapped the stump in the skirt of his cassock, and pressing it to his hip, went back into the room, and standing in front of the woman, lowered his eyes and asked in a low voice, "What do you want?"